satellite images and reports reveal a deeper vulnerability within Israel's defensive operations. The Iron Dome, which many believed could stop almost any missile threat from groups like Palestine Resistance and other Lebanese resistance forces, showed an underwhelming performance. It managed to intercept some of the incoming missiles, including those aimed at Haifa in northern Israel, but it struggled to keep pace with the barrage. In fact, some of its interceptors malfunctioned, landing on civilian homes, causing additional damage rather than preventing it. This has raised urgent questions about the reliability of the Iron Dome, especially when Israeli citizens place their faith in the system at such a critical moment. This unexpected performance failure has inevitably sparked widespread speculation. Many are now asking, what kind of missile was able to penetrate the Iron Dome's defenses? To answer this, we must first look to statements from the Lebanese resistance forces, which revealed crucial information about the offensive. According to a press release from the Lebanese side, the missile that defeated the Iron Dome is a newly developed model called the Fadi 2. This missile, designed by Lebanese resistance engineers, was specifically created to challenge the Iron Dome's ability to intercept and neutralize threats. The Lebanese forces had been preparing this development in secret, and it seems their strategy paid off in the form of a missile capable of bypassing Israel's multi-layered defense systems. The Fadi 2 missile marks a turning point in the evolving dynamic between Israel and its adversaries in Lebanon. Unlike previous models, this missile appears to have been optimized not only for range and precision, but for evading Israel's air defense networks. The missile's ability to strike at strategic locations, such as the Ramat David airbase, one of the most crucial military installations in northern Israel, suggests that it has the power to strike at the heart of Israel's military infrastructure. The satellite images of Ramat David, taken both before and after the strike, show visible damage to the base. This base, originally established as a Royal Air Force RAF airfield during the British Mandate, is now a central hub for Israel's air operations in the north. Its importance cannot be overstated, as it houses the Israeli Air Force's Northern Command and serves as a key point for surveillance and military operations targeting Lebanon, Syria, and Iraq. The destruction of parts of Ramat David Airbase, likely caused by the Fadi 2 missile, represents a significant blow to Israel's military operations in the region. It disrupts their ability to monitor and respond to resistance movements along the northern border, and the loss of such a strategic facility would certainly hamper their intelligence-gathering capabilities. The speculation that the area struck may have housed surveillance systems crucial for operations in Syria, Lebanon, and Iraq only adds to the gravity of the situation. Striking this airbase shows that the Lebanese resistance was not simply retaliating for the series of killings in southern Lebanon. It was sending a clear signal that they have the capability to hit Israel's most critical military assets. The fact that the Iron Dome was unable to fully defend such a vital military target raises serious questions about its future efficacy in larger-scale conflicts. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, in his response to the attack, expressed deep concern about the implications of the strike. His vow to retaliate with overwhelming force against Lebanon reflects his awareness of the significance of this moment. The potential collapse of Israel's ability to monitor northern threats could be disastrous for Israeli defense strategy, especially considering the renewed tensions with Lebanese resistance and other factions. Netanyahu's strong rhetoric indicates that Israel is bracing for a longer, more drawn-out conflict, one that could spiral beyond its current scope and involve other regional powers.
I have a message for the people of Lebanon. Israel's war is not with you. It's with Hezbollah. For too long, Hezbollah has been using you as human shields. It placed rockets in your living rooms and missiles in your garage. Those rockets and missiles are aimed directly at our cities, directly at our
checked shirt. In a moment, he's on the floor, wounded in the midriff. A pager in his bag or on his belt has exploded. CCTV from another shop shows a man check his pager before it too blows up at his side. Scenes like this, playing out hundreds of times across Lebanon within the space of an hour. A targeted, coordinated, highly technical attack.
These pagers exploded while people were on the road, going about their daily lives, basically, in supermarkets and hospitals, driving their cars, getting their kids from school. So It's a huge blow.
Hezbollah had reportedly switched communications from cell phones to pagers to bypass Israeli infiltration attempts. The Reuters news agency, citing security sources, reported the targeted pagers had been supplied just in the last 3 months.
Absolute mayhem from 3:30 onwards for the last few hours. You could just imagine that these pagers were going off across the country, mostly in Beirut, but also in the south and in the Bekaa, and actually also in Syria. And these small explosions are going off in grocery shops next to you, on a moped, somebody, you know, driving next to you, just going off everywhere. And then the wailing of sirens throughout the afternoon, hospitals overwhelmed everywhere. It was absolute chaos and mayhem and fear, because people didn't instantly understand what was going on. It was one explosion and then another, and then it was generalized across the country.
Use by Israel or any country of explosives in handheld devices like walkie-talkies, mobile phones, or pagers, a war crime?
It depends how you use it. You know, Israel has had a long history of using personal electronics as a means of assassination. I think one of the earliest examples was in 1996 when Israel used a cell phone to take out a Hamas bomb maker known as the Engineer. They were able to use a variety of techniques to get the cell phone in his hand. And when it rang and he answered it, Israeli operatives were able to ascertain that he alone was on the phone. And then they detonated the explosives that blew off his head, but only he died. And Israel has used similar tactics to take out individuals. You know, the legality of targeted assassinations up to, you know, states. We know in the United States, the president of the United States apparently can kill anybody he wants to without due process. And the Israelis believe the same thing. But that's one thing. What occurred in Lebanon was something completely different. This is where Israel infected society with devices that society is conditioned to bring in as part of normal everyday operations, pagers, handheld radio, walkie-talkies, etc., and then detonated them at the same time in an indiscriminate fashion. They had no idea who was on the receiving end. They could make assumptions that because these were procured by a Hezbollah procurement agent for the purpose of enabling communication between political and military components of Hezbollah, that there's a good chance a Hezbollah operative would be on it. It's not guaranteed. What if the device was on the counter and the wife heard it and picked it up? What if a child picked it up? What if the husband had it on his hip next to the child? This is indiscriminate act of terror. That's what it is. It's a war crime in the extreme. No American CIA director would ever approve an operation like this. No American president would sign off on this. Nobody in the United States would touch this because it is, by definition, an act of terror, a war crime.
The UN High Commissioner for Human Rights is in full agreement with you, Scott. Cut number 8.
It is a war crime to commit violence intended to spread terror among civilians. I call again for an independent, thorough, and transparent investigation into the circumstances of these explosions. Those who ordered and carried out these attacks must be held
to account. Limit his options. Give him less contact, less access, even if it's just rescinding his mandatory exercise period for a week.
Under what cause?
Whatever cause you want. Wrap it around whatever piece of legal doctrine that helps you rationalize it, Your Honor.
So let me get this straight. You want me to violate his God-given civil rights in the name of some murky sense of the greater good. Is that the gist of it, gentlemen? Okay. I'm game. Just don't plan on it sticking for long. All right.
Wait, are you going to take that? After all the grief you've given me over the cell phone?
Well, that's one of the benefits of being a judge, Mr. Rice. I can pretty much do whatever I want. Hello?
Oh, my God. Back out. Back out.
Barak the Yahweh Shai, giving all praises, honor, and glory to our Heavenly Father, whose name is Yahweh, in the name of His only begotten Son, our Lord and Savior, Yahweh Shai, in the Rekak Wadash, which is the Holy Spirit. Kol Halal Yimla Yahweh Bahasham, Yahweh Shai, Bahasham Rekak Wadash. As always, double honors to the men that taught us His true wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, our apostles and elders, and our leaders of the Church of Great Millstone based out of New York. Shalom, peace and love be unto are you 144,000 men that are laboring to push this true wisdom, knowledge, and understanding to help edify the elect of the nation of Israel. And shalom, peace and love be unto the rest of the elect that are believers. You know, I fucking hate this place, man. I hate it, you know. And I can't wait to the Heavenly Father destroy this fucking hole, you know. And I can't wait to Iran, you know, and all of the rest of these nations that are set up in prophecy, you know, fulfill their portion within prophecy, you know, to help bring this great hole down. You know, I can't wait till Yahweh Shai come, you know, and make moves, you know, make things happen, you know, in that great fathership that He's coming in with those chariots with Him. And I can envision these things in my mind. You know, and I can see them vividly. Now, I'm not saying that that's exactly how it's going to play out. But however, you know, in my mind, you know, I imagine, you know, the great wars that are going to take place, you know, in the Mid-East, as they call it. You know, and all of the nations coming out to battle, you know, to war against each other, you know, to fight within this great fight. You know, I imagine, you know, all of the top officials, you know, in the different militaries around the world. I imagine the generals, you know, with the stars and the decorated, you know, emblems or pendants, whatever it is, you know, on their uniforms or whatever, even though they probably wouldn't go out to battle with that, you know, given the fact that it would help them to be an easy identifiable target, you know, and they'll target them before they'll target anyone else, you know. But however, you know, I imagine, you know, all of the different vehicles, I imagine the planes, you know, the different types of planes that they have. I imagine the helicopters, I imagine the submarines, I imagine the different vessels and boats that they use for the Navy, you know, to carry their airplanes, to carry their soldiers, you know. I imagine all of that. I imagine tanks. I imagine explosions. I imagine bombs popping off. I imagine smoke. And I imagine a very great and fearful sight. And it's all going to start off right here, all right, with these two groups, the Muslims and the Israelis. Now, recently in the news, which they're saying that Israel has entered into an all-out war on five fronts, and it's not something that they can win alone. It ain't something that they can win alone. That's the reason why the scripture say in the book of Jeremiah, the 49th chapter, verse 20, it says, therefore hear these the counsel of Yahweh that He have taken against Edom, and His purpose that He have purposed against the inhabitants of Teman. Surely the least of the flock shall draw them out. Surely He shall make their habitation desolate with them. All right, the earth is moved at their fall, and at the cry, the noise thereof was heard in the Red Sea. So who is it talking about? That's talking about the fall of Edom. Because this war that is going to ignite a greater war, which will be World War III, and technically this is World War III. But however, America will be drawn into the mix. And once they're drawn into the mix, you ain't coming back. All of you soldiers, you know, you might as well kiss your families, have your barbecues, say your goodbye, go off to war, because you ain't going to come back from this one. All right? This is it. You know, this is it. Now, the enemy of Israel, which is right now it's Hezbollah, which is a front group for Iran, is basically saying that all lines have been crossed. Okay? And Iran is basically threatening, look, man, y'all need to fucking do something. You know, all this shit that they're doing it to y'all, and where's the retaliation? You know, I get that before you make a move in war, you have to contemplate or think about, you know, all of the possible outcomes. But they're taking out your top generals. They're taking out your leaders. You know, they're taking out, different officials. They're taking out your delegates. You know, they're popping, you know, bombs off in your land, and you ain't doing no. What the fuck are you gonna do? You know, let's get it cracking, man. Let's get it cracking. All right, the ball is in your hand. It's time for you to do something. How are you gonna retaliate? You know, which I understand that you feel like, you know, that you got the advantage by having the element of surprise, you know, or having your enemy, you know, on the back foot thinking, okay, well, how are they going to retaliate? All right, it's time for you to rise up and do something. You know, and I'm praying through the spirit and power of Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai for this thing to escalate, you know, but we're watching for the major prophecy of the MOTB. So we have to see a shift within his economic structure that turns everything completely digital in the implementation of the RFID C-HIP and the brain C-HIP. So that needs to come, all right, before this major war could really turn into a devastating one that no one is going to win, all right? Only Yahweh Shai and the elect of the nation of Israel. So I want to read a little bit of this, and this also reminds me of the movie. What is that movie called? It's called Something Citizen. You know, I just sent it to brothers yesterday. Law Abiding Citizen. All right, let's look that up real fast. And I'm not going to make this long because I got to dip out. You know, which this movie came out in 2009, Law Abiding Citizen, a very good movie. All right, just to read a little bit of it, Clyde Shelton, all right, which is played by Gerald Butler, is an honorable family man until the day his wife and daughter are unalived in a home invasion. He hopes for justice, but rising prosecutors named Nick Rice, which is Jamie Foxx, cuts a deal with one of the killers in exchange for testimony. 10 years later, that man is found unalive, and Shelton Cooley admits his guilt. Then he hands Rice an ultimatum: fix the broken legal system or suffer consequences. You know, so in this movie, there's a scene where he puts a bomb in the cell phone of the judge, and basically she gets a call, she's talking on it, and next thing you know, pop, you know, like those niggas be popping balloons, you know, on the show. So this technology has been around for a while. It's been around for a while. And guess what? The IDF has had their hands on it for a while. The military has had their hands on it for a while. And this is how they play. So this is definitely a red line. On top of, you know, shooting missiles into Lebanon. And then Netanyahu had the audacity to tell the people of Lebanon, we're not at war with you. How in the fuck can you shoot? Let's say, for instance, somebody comes and shoot bullets into my house, and then they'll tell me, oh, well, we're not at war with you. We just want a particular person that's in your house. But yet my fucking house is destroyed. You know, you didn't hit people in the house that's close to me. So you're out of your damn mind. If you shoot missiles into somebody's country, you're declaring war against the whole country. That you can't make up fucking rules. You can't make up rules, your own rules.
So with all that being said, you know, this is the what's written within prophecy. Okay? This is what's within prophecy. And we're gonna go ahead and go on over to 2 Ezra, the 15th chapter. And we're gonna begin at verse 29 and out 28. Behold, an horrible vision and the appearance thereof from the east. All right, just to give an idea of the region where all of this is taking place, because all of this that's going on now that I just recently spoke about and that you're seeing in the news and brothers are reporting on is happening where? It's happening in the east, where the nations of the dragons of Arabia shall come out with many chariots, and the multitude of them shall be carried as the wind upon the earth, all right, that all they which hear them may fear and tremble. All right, and once again, let's pull that pickup real fast. It says, Israel enters an all-out war on five fronts, and every last country that's against them at this moment that they're fighting against are what? They're all Muslim countries, every last one of them. All right, with the exception of Iran, because Iran would be Elam, the rest of them are all what? The rest of them are considered the dragons of Arabia, or the seed and bloodline of Ishmael. It says also, because this would ties, you know, Iran in there, which Iran's original name is Persia, and another name for them is the Carmanians. All right, you can go and look that up, Carmania. So although they're not Ishmael, but although they're not Arabs, they are tied to them because they are a Muslim nation. Also, the Carmanians raging in wrath shall go forth as the wild boars of the woods, and with great power shall they come and join battle with them, and shall waste a portion of the land of Assyria, of the Assyrians, which the land of the Assyrians in this prophecy would be the land of America, because America is spiritually known as Assyria as well. It says, and then shall the dragons have the upper hand, remembering their nature. And if they shall turn themselves, conspiring together in great power to persecute them. And what is the first nature, or the nature of Ishmael? All right, or these Arabs, or you know, Muslims. All right, their nature is to be what? A wild man. As it states within the book of Genesis, the 16th chapter, verse 12, and he shall be a wild man, and his hand will be against every man, and every man's hand against him, and he shall dwell in the presence of all his brethren. Which the Ishmaelites were blessed too. All right, that's the reason why they have, you know, these different lands with the oil, and they make money or whatever, you know. But they're also wild as hell. Let's see what we can get by looking up the word wild. The word there is parah, and it says a wild ass, you know, a wild ass. Running wild, a sense of running wild. The onager. I believe that's how you pronounce that, wild. All right, so that's the name of a wild ass. But basically, the nature of the Ishmaelites are to be wild. You know, they'll strap a bomb to themselves, you know, and go and destroy, you know, a group of people. They'll put a bomb on them, or, you know, make it explode in a group of people. They're in that nature, you know, so they're tapping back into that. All right, it says, then these shall be troubled and keep silence through their power and shall flee. And from the land of Assyria shall the enemy besiege them and consume some of them. And then their hosts shall be fear and dread and strife among their kings, because this virgin, which is untouched and unfazed by war, is going to eventually be touched herself. You know, you got they're basically saying that the terrorists are coming in through the border too, and they're trying to set up terror rings, all right, here within this place. So you got this place which will be filled with men that are your enemies, and they're going to tear up shit in this place too. They're going to blow things up. There's going to be war here. You're going to have to deploy your soldiers on your own soil in the midst of civil war breaking loose too, as well as race wars. Reading on, it says, behold, clouds from the east and from the north unto the south, they are very horrible to look upon, full of wrath and storm. They shall smite one upon another, and they shall smite down a great multitude of stars upon the earth, or even their own star, and blood shall be from the sword unto the belly. Because when war is fought, as is going to be fought, you know, over there within that region, it causes a lot of smoke. It causes a lot of confusion. There's a lot of bombs going off, a lot of detonating, you know, bombs and missiles and things of that nature that are being shot, you know, and it's going to destroy a lot of these generals. It's going to destroy a lot of these officials and ranking people within these different military structures. And dung of men unto the camel's hoof, because there's going to be a lot of unalive people over, you know, in that region and in different places laid out all over the ground. And there shall be great fearfulness and trembling upon the earth. And they that see the wrath shall be afraid, and trembling shall come upon them, because there has never been, you know, a war on this magnitude that has been fought that's going to involve, you know, this many countries in this type of weaponry. You had World War One, you had World War Two, and you had war, and you will have World War Three. As the scriptures say, the book of Revelation 9:12, it says, one war was past, and behold, there come two wars more hereafter. So World War One and World War Two is nothing in comparison, and will not have as many casualties or damage to infrastructure, all right, and personnel as World War III is going to have. Reading on, it says, and then there shall come storms from the south and from the north, and another part from the west. And strong winds shall rise from the east and shall open it, and the cloud which raised up in wrath, and the star stirred to cause fear towards the east and west wind shall be destroyed. The great and mighty cloud shall be puffed up and full of wrath, and the star, and that they may make all the earth afraid, and them that dwell therein. And they shall pour out over every high and eminent place and horrible star, fire and hail, flying swords and many waters, that all the fields may be filled, and all the rivers with the abundance of great waters. Which the waters can represent the people, you know, like in Revelation 17:15. So there's going to be many nations that come out, you know, with their different militaries and their soldiers, which is going to cover, you know, that region, you know. But with all of the fighting that's going on, there's going to be a lot of casualties. And they shall break down the city and the walls and mountains and hills and trees and woods and grass of the meadows, and their corn, and they shall go steadfastly into Babylon and make her afraid. They shall come to her and besiege her, all right, a star, and all the wrath shall they pour out upon her. Then shall the dust and the smoke go up unto heaven, and all they that be about her shall bewail her, because the end of this great fight and this battle, the ultimate end is going to be thermonuclear destruction, all right, upon this great whore, all right, which is spiritually known as Babylon, but is ultimately known today as what? As America. And they that remain under her shall do service unto them that put her in fear. Okay? So the end result is going to be the destruction of this place, because they're going to shoot those missiles over here. Now, when Iran fully gets involved within this war, who's going to back Iran up? All right, who's Iran's allies? All right, who's going to come to their aid? So no longer does it becomes a five frontier war. You know, it becomes a war that's even larger than that, involving a lot of allies, because there's a lot of people that hate you. There's a lot of people that hate the JJs, the small hats. There's a lot of people that hate America. The book of Revelation 11 and 18, it says, and the nations were angry, and thy wrath has come, and the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that they should as give reward unto the servants, the prophets, and to the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth. So the nations are mad. The nations are angry. And one of the reasons why they're angry is from the faulty deal that they had with you. You know, when they drank of your cup, you know, they got intoxicated, they got inebriated, you know, they got high, you know, they were allured by the beauty, you know, of America, this great hoe, all right, the top hoe in the stable, all right. But then once they came down off of that high, you know, they had that massive headache, that massive migraine, you know, given that they had drunk of the wine of the wrath, you know, of your fornication, you know, the wine in that cup, you know. So now they got that hangover, and they got that anger that comes with that hangover, you know, speaking metaphorically about, you know, them taking on your democracy, your way of life, you know, taking in your falsehoods. All right. And at the end of that, you know, what did they get from that? You know, they didn't get shit, but fucked over. So now they're pissed off, and that's the reason why they're setting up things like BRICS and alliances amongst their own selves, because they're ready to, you know, bring about those judgments that spoke about in Revelation 16, 17, and 18 upon the great whole. So these nations are angry. And the nations that are collaborating together, you know, that are coming together, are written in the scriptures. The book of Ezekiel 38, and beginning at verse 4, it says, and I will turn thee back and put hooks into thy jaws, and I will bring thee forth in all thine army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor, even a great company with bucklers and shields, all of them handling sword. Persia, Ethiopia, Libya, with them, and all them with shields and helmets, Gomer and his bands, the house of Togarmah in the north quarters, and all his bands, and many people with thee. So if you look at the majority of these people that's on here, a lot of them are Muslim nations. Persia, Libya, Ethiopia, I believe it's a mix. Gomer and Togarmah, which represents Turkey, guess what? They're a Muslim nation. All right? Be thou prepared, and prepare for thyself, thou and all thine company, all right, that are assembled unto thee, and be thou a guard unto them. So the number one nation, all right, is Russia, okay? Which is Gog from the land of Magog, all right, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. Which will be a guard to these other nations. So they're going to step in, as well as China, as an ally for Iran. And some major shit is about to happen. All right. So look forward to the MOTB. All right. Look at that prophecy. All right. As you watch, you know, the turnout of what's going to take place, you know, over within, all right, that particular region, which is going to spark a very chaotic war. All right, look also for the prophecy of the MOTB, because we're at the door of that thing. You know, it's already here. The infrastructure is laid. They just have to implement it. So with that, I truly hope that this lesson has been edifying, giving all praises, honor, and glory to our Heavenly Father, whose name is Yahweh, in the name of Yahweh Shai, in the Rekach Kodash, which is the Holy Spirit. Double honors to our apostles and our elders of the Church of Great Millstone. Peace, love, salutations, and mercy be unto the hopeful elect. Shalom.